Spirit, you are here. Spirit, you are here and you love it. Holy Spirit, you are here. Spirit, you are here and you love it. You made me a dwelling place. You made me your home and you love it. Oh, you made me a dwelling place. You made me your home and you love it. Holy Spirit.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord, I've tasted and seen. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of love. When my heart becomes free and my shame is of none, your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, and fill me, I must fill. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. In your presence, Lord.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let
Church. What a joy it is to be together in worship today, both in person and online. Welcome this morning. We are a church that is seeking Christ and sharing his love and living that out day by day, and we're just glad to be together. Jim and Valina are out of town this week, so we're excited to welcome Dr. Antipas Harris to the pulpit this morning, and he will be in Matthew chapter 4. So if you want to go ahead and mark your Bibles now to be ready. We're in a season that we're calling Renew, looking at what the Bible tells us about new seasons and leaving things behind and bringing things forward. So exciting stuff for this for us this morning. Our call to worship comes from the psalmist. Psalm 113, it says, "Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore." Let us stand and worship our God.
We love you this morning. You are our daily bread. Giver of life, you are our daily bread. We join with the heaven and sing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah.
For the Lord God Almighty reigns.
like you, there's no other. Like you, there's no other. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. And worthy is the Lamb, and worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
It's such a joy to be together in community this morning. I encourage you to let us know you're worshiping with us online. You can click the link above where you're watching that says fill out your connection card. There's a place there to share prayers. For those of you in person, you also have the same card, just a paper version. Unless you want to be high tech, there is a QR code. You can use your phone's camera app to scan that and fill it out online. Wherever you're filling out your connection card, though, you have an opportunity to share prayers with us, and I encourage you to do that. If you check confidential, only our pastors will see it. Otherwise, our prayer teams, elders, and deacons will pray over those in the coming hours and days, and it's a rich privilege and blessing for us to do so. We have some other ways to be in. Sorry, let me back up. While you're doing that, you can also do your offering as well. There's a link that says to give online, or you can text your offering. That number is 757-530-5683. If you have a paper offering, a check, or money, cash, we're going to do the baskets later in the service, so I will give you instructions on that in a bit. We have some other ways to be together in fellowship this week, exciting ways for us to be in community. The first one, though, is a way for us to grow together in discipleship. In your bulletin, you have an insert that says renew at the top, week six. Each week, Valina puts together this great devotional that has the scripture for the week, as well as other scripture readings and guided questions, and also links to podcasts and videos and deeper information on the scripture for that week. I encourage you to take advantage of that and to dive in deeper. And we also have an opportunity for discipleship together on Zoom Wednesday evening this week at 7 p.m. Pastor Jim will be talking about a great question as Halloween approaches. Should Christians celebrate Halloween? Join us on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. to find out. And one other announcement, there's no youth group this evening, but Sticky Faith has decided to have an impromptu s'more party. If you want information about that, if you've got a middle schooler or a high schooler and you want to join them for s'mores, there's information at the Welcome Center outside in the Commons. Hunter is going to come up to hang out with our little people.
Excellent. All right, kiddos, come on up. And while I'm waiting for the kids that will be dismissed for children's church after this, come on, I'm so excited. I want to let you know that I had a couple of days at home last week, and I brought my phone up here because I have a new hobby. And last weekend, I watched movies, and I discovered something on my phone called TikTok. Have y'all heard of TikTok? So I started watching TikTok last weekend because I realized that you could type it in and you could watch all golden retriever videos. And so I started watching golden retrievers bringing their parents' slippers. I started watching golden retrievers dressed up for Halloween. I spent hours watching golden retriever videos, and then I realized there was so much more on TikTok than just golden retriever videos. So I've learned how to organize my pantry this past week. I have learned all kinds of stuff, what you should buy at Costco, what you shouldn't buy at Costco. And so I brought my phone up with me because I realized, and I just got a message that said my screen time was up this week, which explains a lot because I'm really into TikTok right now. And so I was thinking about my phone and how important my phone is, because not only can I watch TikTok, but I can get text messages from my daughter. She texts me regularly saying that she's forgotten something at school and she needs me to bring her uniform. Come on up. How are you this morning, Sadie? My parents will call me and I don't always answer the phone, and that makes them very angry at me. Very, very angry when I don't answer the phone. But I start thinking about the fact that you can get all kinds of messages on your phone. Well, today we have a message that God wants to hear from us, but it's not going to be on a phone. It's going to be where? Bible. Hold on. Cole, you want to hold the microphone? All right. test it and see if it's working.
Testing, 1, 2, 3.
So it's going to be, so where is the message going to be today?
The Bible.
Excellent. That's absolutely perfect. So today the message is going to be in the Bible, and my friend Antipas is going to be teaching from the New Testament, and we know the New Testament is after who was born?
Jesus,
that's exactly right. And so Jesus was walking around the Sea of Galilee, and he came up upon two people, Simon and Andrew. And do you know what kind of jobs they had? They were by the water, they had nets, they were trying to catch
fish.
So what were their jobs?
To be fishermen.
And Jesus walked upon them and they said, put your nets down and come and catch what?
Fish.
Not fish. What did Jesus say we were going to fish? Men, right?
Men, yeah.
So he took Simon and Andrew and they kept walking along and they found two more fishermen, James and John, and James and John dropped their nets and they became followers of Jesus. What do we call followers of Jesus?
Disciples.
That's exactly right. And so they became disciples. So not only is this message for the 12 disciples that Jesus had follow him, but they're for us too. So he's calling us to follow him too. And how can we be fishers of men? Do you know the answer to that? How can we be fishers of men? Do you want to let Caleb try?
We can teach people about God.
That's right. That's exactly right. We can teach people about God and we can read the Bible and we can come to church. And so we're supposed to follow Jesus, but we're also supposed to follow his example. Kind of like, have you ever played Simon Says or follow the leader in church at school?
Yeah.
And so you're supposed to do what the leader is doing. So we're supposed to follow Jesus's example in the Bible by sharing the gospel, by being kind, by loving each other. And so there's all kinds of ways that God is calling us to be fishers of men too and to follow Jesus. So today, I'm gonna close this in prayer and we're all gonna say amen. But before I close this in prayer, I wanna talk about something fun that we're gonna have for our fall festival. How many of you have been to church for our fall festival before? Does everybody have their costumes ready?
Yeah.
You are? What are you gonna be?
Batman,
what are you going to be?
Batgirl.
What are you going to be?
Ninja.
Ninjas?
Mario.
Princess?
A princess. That's perfect. Do y'all know what you're going to be? Mm-hmm. What?
A mermaid.
Oh, that's, you're going to have a hard time walking. What are you going to be, rolled in? Or is it going to be a walking mermaid costume? Yeah, a walking one. That would probably be better. So next Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday, we're going to have our fall fest. Yes.
I did forget you.
Alligator. What are you going to be?
Alligator.
What?
Alligator.
An alligator? You're going to have a hard time walking, too. I'm going to have to get something to push all around.
Princess Peach.
A princess?
Princess Peach.
Are you going to have a pea?
Peach.
Oh, Princess Peach. What is that? I'm sorry. Clearly, I clearly have a 15-year-old now and not a little kid. So this is so exciting. So listen, next Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday at 6 p.m., we're turning our fall festival into a trunk or treat, which means we need trunks. So look at all these sweet children here, folks. And if you don't sign up to park your car and pass out candy, all of these kids will be standing in the parking lot without any treats. And that will be the saddest thing in the world that I will have to do, is to tell these kids that their church family members didn't sign up to pass out candy. So you can text me at 757-675-3700. And if you want to just use your trunk, we can give you candy. If you want to bring 300 pieces of candy, we plan on having 300 kids. 300, because there's a load of you kids. So text me at 675-3700 and say that you don't want to disappoint these sweet little angels that are going to come as mermaids and alligators and Princess Peach. I won't know who that is until I see her. I'm super excited. And so I'm going to close this in prayer and we will see y'all next Wednesday from 6 to 7. We've got balloon artists. We've got a petting zoo coming. We've got all kinds of snacks and all kinds of candy if these people sign up. All right. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord, and thank you for your children, and thank you for your opportunity that you have given us to become fishers of men, Lord, and that we can be your disciples right now, Lord, and we can follow your example, and we can live just like you, Lord. We are so thankful to be here at church and to have a children's church and to have an opportunity to hear my friend Antipas speak your word today. In your heavenly name, amen. All right, let's go to children's church.
Good morning, church. I guess I should take this off. I'm so much a part of us that I forget I have it on. If you turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 4, and verses are 18 through 22. Matthew 4, 18 through 22, page 968 in your pew Bible. If you're there, say amen. If you're not, say wait. Looks like we're there, have it. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. The word of the Lord. Dear Lord, I pray that you consecrate these moments, consecrate our ears of clay, consecrate my lips of clay. May you speak through me to us. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. So I really like fishing, and I often, when I'm in town, I go with Bob Gale on his boat or with Tracy on his boat. When I'm with Bob, we go line fishing. That's throwing the rod. And when I'm with Tracy, we often go net fishing. So it's I enjoy doing both. But you know, fishing is not... The good thing about fishing is not the fishing itself necessarily, though you hone the skills, you develop the ability to do it, you know where to go, you know how to catch, you know, bait fish and all of that. But the real joy of fishing is not fishing itself, it's the experience. It's going with a friend and having great conversation and making sure you got the keg, making sure anyway. There are things that you do on the boat that make the experience that it is. So fishing itself is not enough. So the title of my message today is When Fishing is Not Enough. Translating it to the message for today, fishing becomes a symbol or an example or a metaphor for any occupation that you may have. The men in the text were engaging fishing as an occupation, not so much for recreation like I would. There was Peter and his brother Andrew. They were fishing because they would sell fish to the market and they would make a living and bring, you know, resources back home and build a family. Or if it was the sons of Zebedee, they were mending nets as part of the occupation. But in the text, Jesus encounters them and he, in so many words, suggested them that you are doing a great job, but what you're doing is not enough. For us today, the question is not what we do. The question is why. And you know, Mark Twain said that there are two important days of our lives, the day that we were born and the day we found out why. Why did God bless you with the gifts, the talents, and the opportunities that you have? You know, as a young boy, I remember my brothers and I would play music in the church, and there was a young lady who said to me that she didn't know her purpose. In fact, she said, I don't think I have one. And I said, why do you say that? She said, well, I don't sing, and I don't preach, and I don't play music. And then I said, do you think the your purpose is only one or two things? Or what God could call one to do? God could call people to do who are in any occupation. It's not the what, it's the why. It's not a limited amount of sort of activities in the church that we can designate as purposeful. But whatever you do, whether you're a street sweeper or a pilot, and I really hope the pilots have purpose, because I'm oftentimes in planes, and I'm always praying for pilots, and the pilots in the house. Creighton, there you are. I pray for you, brother. The point that I'm making is that what we do, no matter what our occupations are, they all have the potential of divine purpose. When we understand what we do, careers and activities are not an end in themselves, we submit to a journey of discovery, and I dare I say, divine discovery. Abraham, in Genesis chapter 12, Abraham had to follow God from the land of Ur, where he was born and raised, to a land that he did not know. He was willing to do it, though, because he understood that place and activity have little value in and of themselves. I want to say this again. Place and activity have little value in and of themselves. So Abraham left the land of Ur and pursued God's purpose for his life. And that must have been a difficult idea to have to explain to his wife that he was going somewhere and he didn't know where he was going. And you're going with me. So you're leaving the familiar to go to the unfamiliar and inviting your family to go on this journey with you, because this is not just a meandering in the wilderness of not knowing, but it is a journey of divine discovery. Repeat after me, the journey of divine discovery. The same is true in our text today. Jesus is calling disciples, watch this, to a higher awareness. I know what you do, but I want to call you to a higher awareness of why you do what you do. It is awareness of purpose. Many people live their whole life and never really find out why they do what they do, other than to make money, to make a living, because they like it, you see. There are many fishermen, but the beauty of this text is that there are men who Jesus encounters, and he calls them to a great awareness of their purpose. Purpose is so important. We get up in the morning and we're excited about life when we know why. The first call in the text is to follow Jesus. Jesus tells them, follow me. That's what he says to Peter and Andrew in the first. It is a radical and a bold invitation. Dietrich Bonhoeffer writes in his book, Cost of Discipleship, is really an expository on the Sermon on the Mount, but and we know what happened to Dietrich Bonhoeffer. In many ways, a manifesto of his faith. It was sort of his statement of allegiance to Christ and allegiance to Christ to the extent of death, when he says, when Christ calls a person, Christ bids him to come and die. It sounds crude, morbid, but what he's really saying is there is a sense of coming, but you're dying to yourself. Self-aggrandizement. Dying to an idea, right? Dying to the commitment to, I gotta be in control, to this idea that I have to be in control. Because we know where we've been, we have a sense of mastery on things that we have experienced, but what if we're called to something that we never encountered before? The mystery is almost, the mystery is mystifying, And in many ways, it causes us to want to stick with the familiar because we can be in control of that. If you're like me, a type A personality, I need to be in control. Somebody said the other day that my team at the school where I'm the president, they said, well, we're waiting on the JDS team to approve something. And I said, whoa, go back to that. What? You haven't approached me about anything to approve. And I started to get nervous because I thought, now I'm feeling out of control because you're saying that something needs to be approved that I haven't even seen. Type A personality, I need to be out and ahead of this thing because I don't want anybody to say that I didn't do what I was supposed to do. It's the personality thing. But the call of Christ is to push us out of control. Well, we really don't know what's going to happen next. That's the call of Christ. He says that birds have nests and foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. So I'm going to leave the familiar to follow somebody who has nowhere to lay his head. That's the call of discipleship, though. Second point, and I got a lot of points, so if you're taking notes. The purpose expressed in today's text is that true discipleship is fulfilling Christ's mission, watch this, in service to others. They are fishing for fish, but the call is for them to fish for people. Christ's mission is in service to other people. There is a people focus. Whatever we're called to do, an awareness of others is part of the purpose of discovery, that I don't do what I do for me, I do what I do for other people. And how are the skills that I've attained, how are the gifts that I have, translate this to you. I'm saying me, but I'm saying you. Yeah. We. How do they translate to support and development of other people? Next point. When God calls us to deeper insight. You're fishing for fish, but I'm going to make you fishers of people. What's that? What's that? What's fishing for people? The first beauty of this is that Christ uses language that they can understand. He enters into the world of language, fishing, and he uses the language of fishing in order to communicate to them. And that's the beauty of Jesus, is that he has a way of entering into our world of career, our world of familiarity, and using signs and symbols and language that we can understand to communicate a message. So when he says, go fish for people, at least they understand fishing. They don't quite understand what the deal is about fishing for people. But this is a mystery, and it's quite an important one because they were Jews, and Jews had no dealing with the Gentiles, right? So this idea that you're going to go fishing reminds me of when I'm on the boat with Tracy and he throws the net and we go to pull the net. We kind of don't know what's going to be in the net when we go. So there's a deeper insight that Christ is calling for. He's saying to him that you're going to be fishing for people. That means that when you throw the net, you don't know what you're going to get. Maybe some Gentiles in there. People you don't understand, people you don't like, people you can't relate to, but you can understand fishing, right? So it's going to be kind of like that, net fishing. That's the beauty of this, is that there's a deeper revelation of purpose that suggests that the purpose in whatever we do is beyond the thing itself, extend it to others, and there are people oftentimes who we can't particularly relate to. I always, when I'm teaching, preaching, and I do an example of preaching, I go to John 3:16, and I often preach the sermon, for God so loved the world, depending on where you emphasize the word in the text, is where you land your point. Like, for God so loved the world. God, the eternal one. There's no one beside him. There was no one before him, nor no one after him. God, somebody say God. You see. But if I say, for God so loved the world, then the emphasis is on love. Love. What does love mean? You know, and you emphasize that. Or you say, for God so loved the world. God loved the world? The world is big. There are people in the world I don't like. You want me to tell you who they are? Well, it said that God loved the world, so God loved people I don't like. And God loves more than Christians because there are more than Christians in the world. Oh, so God loves people who are not Christians? Absolutely. For God so loved the world. In the text today, when you're fishing for people, you're entering into a world of discovery. Purpose drives us into a world of discovery, a world of service and fulfilling the call of God in many spaces and places in life that we cannot imagine. Yet, Jesus calls ordinary people in their skills of fishing to a service that will ultimately change the entire world. And that's the same with us. God calls us to deeper insight, to go deeper. We must leave the superficial, the mundane, and the routine. Consider what Peter had to walk away from and ask yourself, what must I also walk away from in order to pursue the purpose by design? Because the challenge is that we accumulate a lot of stuff around our activity, and it makes us feel secure and makes us feel important, quite frankly. And then there are times when Christ comes and calls us away to pursue purpose, and we can't pursue purpose with an allegiance to familiarity. We can't pursue purpose with an allegiance to familiarity, because purpose inevitably is a call from that which we are most familiar with. Not only the that, but the them. They're being called away from the other fishermen to fish for people. How do you explain that to the other fishermen? Oh, I'm going to go start fishing for people. They say, what does that mean? That's crazy. Yet the call to purpose was drawn upon the skills they had acquired already and launching them into a world that is beyond the familiar, beyond the superficial, beyond the mundane. Yet the skills, and I always look for this when I interview people, I'm looking for the skills that are transferable or translatable. In other words, you have skills in this area, but I want to see if I can transfer those skills into something else. Or maybe it's a skill that you call it this over here, and I want to translate it to this over here. And sometimes I rather find those kind of people, because the people who think they already know and got the experience, they'll come into the organization and try to strong arm the organization to what they came from. But if you get people who have skills that are transferable, there's a sense of humility because they don't really know this job to start with. So you help them start to translating and transferring their skills into what you really need. But anyway, that's beside the point. The point here is that they had to transfer and translate their skills in fishing to this fishing for people. The skills were for God's divine purpose, and they were not for personal fulfillment. They were bigger than occupational duties, and they were bigger than employment. They were for God's divine purpose. Because when we submit to discipleship, discipleship means to learn, apprenticeship, to grow, to develop, and all of those things. But most importantly, discipleship is a journey of discovery. Say that again. I said it about three times all the time, but I want you to leave this place today with that in our heads, that discipleship is a journey of discovery. Journey of discovery. I'm finding stuff out about me as well as I'm finding stuff about God. My next point. When God calls us from dependence on ourselves, our gifts, our talents. God calls us from the familiar and from dependence on our circle of connections. What are you depending on? What do you need to give up to follow Jesus? And then, what is this idea of fishing for human beings? fishing for people. Proverbs 11 and 30 states, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and whoever captures souls is wise. Whoever captures souls is wise. What is capturing souls? Is the call to be a fisher of human beings really a call to wisdom when he says to that whoever wins souls is what King James Version of the Bible says, or captures souls is what the ESV says, is wise? Is this really a call to wisdom? Perhaps Peter had the wisdom to do more than what he was doing. Perhaps you have the wisdom to do more than what you're doing, but it's only the purpose by design that we discover in Christ that draws out the wisdom. That's the other thing. See, when you work, you don't just work with skills, but you develop a type of wisdom. It's kind of like you go to school for law, and then you practice law and discover that there is a lacuna between the study of law and the practice of law, or in seminary, you know, it's like you go study all this stuff, and then you actually do ministry, and there's a lacuna between the two, or medicine, or whatever your occupation is. Sometimes skill development needs wisdom for application. So this idea of being called by God is a call to wisdom, a call to exercising the wisdom that you have acquired, a transference of wisdom. It is a call to a higher potential. Today, Jesus is calling us to our highest potential. Jesus is calling us to our highest potential. I want to challenge you to employ your gifts, your skills, your talents in ways that are beyond your experience. Let's pursue wisdom for greater creativity to bear witness to Christ in the world. Bear witness to Christ in the world. I want you to repeat something else after me. The world needs me. And that's not an arrogant statement. That is a statement of commitment to community, the beloved community, a statement of acknowledgement of belonging. I belong here. You belong here. The worst thing we can ever experience is a feeling of not belonging. Because when we don't belong, if we feel like we don't belong, then we're not willing to contribute anything to the advancement of where we are. The world needs us. The world needs leaders. The world needs disciples of Christ to bear witness to the work of Christ in the world. This is the call and the cost of discipleship. Let me say this. In the text, the level of radical faith that it takes to say yes to Jesus cannot be overstated. It is unprecedented because the call of discipleship is a call to radical commitment. It's a call to moving away from, to moving to something. And the yes is a loaded yes because we don't really know what we're saying yes to. Yet we submit to the journey because there's something about the journey in which we discover our purpose. Andrew is also an important character in the text because of his covenant with his brother Simon to walk this out. The reason I highlight this is because this yes that we say to Christ is a personal commitment, but it is an entrance into community. It was a mutual support, a mutual walking out. In both cases, whether it was John and James or Simon and Andrew, they were each called together. Each had to make the decision, but together they walked this out. Sisters and brothers, together we walk this out in community. The call of discipleship is not a call to individuality. It's a call to community, participation, mutuality. It's a call to a beloved community that bears witness in the world and brings people to the experience of life of abundance in Christ. It reminds me that when we do this sort of net fishing, we're going to get people who have all kinds of issues in their life. If you cross-reference this text with Luke 5, 1 through 11, Jesus shows up while they are fishing and they haven't caught anything. They had the right skills, but they had no fulfillment. They had the right experience, but they were not able to achieve what they were trying to achieve. Is that any of us in here today? You got the right training, got the right experience, but something is just not adding up. Jesus shows up and tells them to launch out into the deep. They launch out into the deep, and they could barely bring in all the fish that they brought in. They were overwhelmed, appalled, quite embarrassed that they had toiled all night. Jesus said, "Don't worry, because from now on out, you're going to be fishers of people." That text is important to bring up because he says, launch out into the deep. When we launch out into the deep and we pull in the net, there are people who are in the deep who are in deep depression. They're in deep chaos. Some have played out with their own families. Some are living on the street. Some don't have jobs. Some never went to school. Some can't read. Some are experiencing food insecurity. Some have given up on themselves, struggling in one way or the other. Some are going through some terrible times and turbulent times in their life. Yet Jesus says, launch out into the deep because I love them too. And your purpose is to reach those who are way down in the deep, way down in the deep. That's the fun stuff. It's fun when we can reach out and extend a hand up rather than merely a hand out. And we pull people from where they are together to be with us because there are no big eyes or little U's. We're all called to the same boat, and that is the boat of discipleship. A call to pull people out of deep is a call to help people. When fishing is not enough, when your occupation is not enough, that's when we discover purpose. But not in and of itself. It's the journey of discovery of purpose. That's the beauty of the call to discipleship. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, we're called also to be a people of prayer as we pray for one another in our world. Before we do lift up our prayer requests, there are baskets in the center aisle. After we pray, I'm going to invite you to pass those to the outside and place your connection cards and your offerings in those, and our ushers will collect them. Before we pass that basket, though, I invite you to hold your connection card and any prayers you may have written as we lift those up and other prayers as well. This morning, in particular, we want to be in prayer for peace in our world and reconciliation in our nation. We lift up continued prayers for refugees all around the world, but especially those in Afghanistan. And we lift up Massanutten Springs Conference Center in the western part of Virginia, where we spend our summers on our family mission trip. They have answered the call to host many of those refugees, and we have been called into a privilege to partner with them and to support that. So we prayers all around for the community, for the refugees, the workers, and those supporting financially. We continue to pray for recovery for Chris McKinnon Hing. Last week, through our prayer requests on Sunday and throughout the week as we worship together, we received 155 prayer requests from our family, the FPC family. Prayers for friends and family, health issues, requests for healing, prayers for provision, guidance, and discernment. Friends, let's hold all of these prayers together as we go before the throne in prayer. Gracious Lord, we come before you this morning with hearts full of praise and worship and gratitude. We praise your holy name. We hold you above all things, Lord. We thank you this morning especially for the vision, for the reminder, for your words that you call us first to simply come to be in your presence. You call us to follow you. Lord, we ask that we are able to follow so closely in the dust of our rabbi, in the dust of Jesus. And we also are thankful for the reminder and the words that you call us to follow you to discipleship, to a journey of discovery, and then you send us out to do the work of your hands and your feet, of your kingdom in this world, Lord. And we thank you for the privilege. We ask for courage, for strength, to and discernment as we go as you would have us to go. We come before you and your throne this morning in community, and we pray and we join our voices together in community as we pray in the way that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to pass the baskets toward the outside, place your connection cards in your offering, and then stand with us as we continue to worship.
Hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, you're the great I am, who is worthy, none beside me, God Almighty, you're the great I am. One more time. Hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, you're the great I am. Who's worthy? Who is worthy? None beside thee.
None beside
God Almighty, you're the great I am. I want to be close. I wanna be close, close to your side. Heaven is real, death is a lie. I wanna hear voices of angels above, singing as one. Hallelujah. Demons run and flee at the mention of the name, the King of Majesty. There is no power in hell or anyone who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am.
What we do is not enough for fulfilling our purpose in life, but submitting to the discovery of discipleship is paramount to our fulfillment of purpose and meaning in life. As we leave this place, I pray that we will go not with the spirit of a Jonah, for example, who was not willing to do all of what God had called for him to do, and he was swallowed by a fish, but rather, we be like the disciples of Christ who followed Christ and were able to catch people for Christ's service in the world. After this, at 10 o'clock, I'll be teaching a class in this room called Faith That Ends Well in the series, and so I hope you'll stick around for that class. It should be a fun class. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless before the Almighty God, to whom belong dominion and power now and forever, we give you the honor and the praise. As we leave this place, but not your presence, be with us on the dangerous highways, the byways, the alleyways, the walkways, the airwaves, the trainways, however we shall travel. May we bear witness to your truth and your goodness in a world that is in desperate need of it. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and bring you peace. The Lord bless you. The Lord bless you.
Have a blessed week.